And it was called, Your Mom Lied to You. And it was really just a list of all those unknowing, I'll give them the benefit of that, but it was unknowing, all the unknowing lies that our mom told to us, and that we then told to our children, and so on and so forth. And the first lie was, you need to put hydrogen peroxide on that. You must have heard that. You see, it turns out that those healing bubbles are actually attacking your body. The latest research says it actually causes cellular damage, can actually extend the healing process. That's right, it takes longer to heal if you use hydrogen peroxide. Thanks, Mom. Another lie, cracking your knuckles will give you arthritis. A lot of us bought into that one, didn't we? But the latest knuckle-cracking research, and surprisingly enough, there's quite a bit of knuckle-cracking research out there. The latest research says it doesn't cause arthritis. And my favorite study is from this doctor in California. You see, for 60 years, he did an experiment on himself. Every day, twice a day, on his left hand, he cracked every knuckle, twice a day, every day. That's some 438,000 times. But on his right hand, they were left completely uncracked. And at the end of 60 years, not a single bit of difference. You see, knuckle cracking doesn't cause arthritis. So I thought we could celebrate this together today. So on the count of three, let's all crack our knuckles together. That might be hard for some of you, I know. You bought into it. You still think your mama was telling you the truth. Or maybe you just don't care what the research says. Maybe you're one of those legalistic people that even if the rules don't make sense, you're still going to follow them. I want to set you free from that today. So let's all just be free. So on the count of three, I get a feeling some of you are buying into this. But we're going to do it anyway. It's going to happen. You're not too good for the rest of us, those who don't want to do it. So here we go. On the count of three, let's get ready. One, two, three. All right. Doesn't that just make you feel better? You see, it feels good to be bad, doesn't it? So the legitimate research, and this is my own personal legitimate research, it's not published yet, but it will be someday. The primary negative impact of cracking your knuckles is the annoyance to the people sitting next to you. So you're welcome. We just proved it today. Lie number three. Don't swallow your gum because it takes how long?
7 years
for you to digest it. Not true. You see, we live with this weight, this fear that gum is just piling up in our stomach. But it's hard not to swallow gum, isn't it? You know, you're reaching the point where it wants to be swallowed. And how can it be wrong when it feels so right? Well, it turns out you're fine. It doesn't sit in your stomach for 7 years. So the next time you're chewing gum and you don't have anywhere to put it when you're done chewing it, embrace your inner rebel and swallow it. You see, my point is, there are certain things that we just accepted. We just go along with. And we pass them on to our children. We're all told some of these same things. So it must be true, right? And we end up spending our lives pouring hydrogen peroxide on our wounds, abstaining from the pleasure of cracking our knuckles, for no reason whatsoever. But what if? What if instead of some of these minor issues, What if we've accepted some things that have much more significant implications, more dire ramifications? You see, if you studied the ministry of Jesus, here's what you're going to find. He spent a significant amount of his time teaching as a rabbi. And a significant amount of that time was debunking the myth that people had been told and people had been taught about God and about faith. He would say, "You've heard it said like this, but I'm going to tell you something different. I know you've been taught to look at it this way, but I'm going to give you a new way to look at it." So he came on the scene and he confronted some of those false beliefs about faith, about religion, about God that many people had just accepted. And we'll see in this series that many of the spiritual leaders of Jesus' day made the focus on the outside. That's what it meant to follow God. You had to have it all together. You had to keep up your appearances. You had to follow all the right rules and keep all the right rituals. But then Jesus came along. And he said, "I know you've been taught that it's what's on the outside that matters. But it's really what's about on the inside." And that's what's on the inside that then comes out. It's an inside-out kind of way of following God. You see, for many of us, that's not how we understood it. We learned to kind of keep track of how we were doing on the outside. We learned to keep up appearances, to make sure everybody knew that we had a smile on our face and everything was good and we didn't have any problems. But God says, "Look, man may look on the outside, but I look at the And it's hard for people to accept that. But Jesus comes along and he turns some things upside down and inside out. And I know this may be hard to believe for us. But there were some people in his culture that actually created an environment in the temple, in the house of God, where certain people didn't feel welcome. I mean, it's hard for us to imagine that. But certain people felt like they weren't good enough to take part in worship. And it's hard for us to wrap our minds around that today. But they made things like how you dress a really big deal. That was somehow an indication of your spiritual depth. And it's hard for us to picture that today. It may sound a little bit crazy, but they would get uncomfortable if someone would get too expressive in how they worship God. And a big thing for them, and again, it's hard for us to grasp this, but back then, not now, back then when people came to worship, they felt like they had to have it all together. They felt like they couldn't have any problems, like their families couldn't struggle, like they didn't have anything hidden in their closet. And again, this isn't something that we've had any problems with. But back then, the house of God ended up being a place where it wasn't safe to talk about your struggles. Where it wasn't safe to deal with your hurts or your failures. So people were made to believe that some things that weren't true about Jesus, and Jesus is going to address these, some of these commonly held myths. And instead of looking like you have it all together, he wants authentic worship. Instead of carefully observing all these religious rituals, he wants an intimate relationship. And instead of acting more righteous than you really are, what he wants is brokenness. Brokenness is a word that we don't use much these days. It's not something that most people aspire to. Broken isn't what you list on your resume. Doesn't work really well in the boardroom either. You see, we live in this culture that's been called a throwaway culture. When things break, we throw it away. We don't value repairing anything, fixing anything, making things new. When they break, we just throw it away and do it something else. And so Jesus gives us kind of this different lens to look at broken things through. And it's an invitation to us as a church. Jesus is going to say, come here. I want you to look at the world through my eyes. Step in here and look at that person through the lens that I'm looking at them through. And when Jesus looks at the broken, he sees beautiful. He sees something that's valuable. William MacDonald, in his book, Lord Breakthrough, begins it this way. Usually when someone is broken, when something is broken, its value declines. But this isn't the way things work in the spiritual realm. In the world we know, if something breaks, the value goes down. But God puts a premium on broken things, especially broken people. When God sees broken, he sees beautiful. And I want to talk about an example of that today. And it's in Luke 7. And rather than reading you the text, I'm just going to share the story with you. And this afternoon, if you want, you can go home and open up your Bible and you can read it for yourself. But let me just tell the story. You see, Jesus is in town. And he's been invited over to the house of Simon, the Pharisee, a religious leader. And it was Simon's duty to invite the visiting rabbi into his home. So he invites Jesus over to him. But Simon's heart, his heart wasn't in it. You see, Simon doesn't even give him a greeting. We would shake somebody's hand if they come to the house. In that day, he should have kissed him on the cheek, or at least kissed him on the hand. Simon doesn't do either of those. And when it's time to eat, Simon doesn't make sure that the feet of Jesus have been washed, which is just kind of a minimal thing that you would do in that time. At least you would give him his own water so that he could wash his own feet. Simon doesn't do any of that. And if you want to especially honor a guest like a rabbi, you would give them some olive oil for anointing their head with oil. It's an inexpensive gesture, but a hospitable one, nonetheless. And Simon doesn't do any of these things. Jesus comes in, he sits down, and Simon doesn't honor him. But this is when a woman comes onto the scene, and things start to get a little bit awkward. You see, she's a sinner, and everyone knows that she's a sinner. She was a prostitute. People are uncomfortable when she comes in. Why was she there? She must have seen or heard something of Jesus. And she knew that as broken as she was, she could still be made whole. And God could somehow still do something with the broken pieces of her life. So in her brokenness, she shows up to this dinner party. This was not a safe place for her to be. She would have avoided places like this at all costs. She had to see Jesus again. She knew how people would look at him as broken beyond repair. A Pharisee would see someone who was a throwaway. But she knows that that's not how Jesus sees her. So she's going to do something that many of us might consider as impulsive, embarrassing, inappropriate, unacceptable. You see, Jesus is reclining at the table. And the woman approaches, and she's standing at the filthy feet of Jesus. Everyone's quiet. She feels the stares of condemnation. Other people won't even look up. They're looking at the ground because it's a sin to even look like. They're embarrassed by her presence. But not Jesus. She looks at Jesus, and he seems to know what happened in her heart. And in some way, he lets her know that she's welcome. Maybe it was a warm smile, but he's delighted that she is there, that she has come. And she's undone by this. And the tears begin to flow. And she falls on the ground and she begins to kiss his feet. And that's when she notices something. As the tears from her eyes land on his feet, there are these muddy feet. And it strikes her. His feet were washed. And the funny thing about tears is that oftentimes it's only when they fill our eyes that we can finally see some things clearly. And she knows what she needs to do. She doesn't have a towel. And in this place, she couldn't ask for one. So she lets down her hair. Now, for a woman in that culture, that wasn't appropriate. That was an especially intimate gesture. You wouldn't do this in public. You would only do that between a wife and a husband in the privacy of your home. But she lets down her hair and she begins to wash the feet of Jesus with her tears and dry them with her hair. And she had this bottle of perfume around her neck. Most likely used in her profession. You know, one drop at a time, many times, with many men. But she just doesn't put a drop on Jesus' feet. She dumps the whole thing out. She pours it all out. Her whole life, she empties it. She's broken. It was inappropriate. It was reckless. It was impulsive. And Jesus says, it's beautiful. He sees the broken as beautiful. He just turns everything upside down and inside out. He condemns, rather, he rebukes Simon the Pharisee. So you've got this religious leader who has his whole act together. He follows all the rules. He does everything he's supposed to do. And Jesus rebukes him. And he turns around and he commends this prostitute who's a broken mess. Turns everything upside down. And he ends the story by giving this lady incredible value and purpose. He says to her, your sins are forgiven. Your faith has saved you. Go in peace. And she is made whole. I've got a trick question for you. I'm telling you up front, this is a trick question, but I'm going to ask it anyway. Who would you rather be in this story? Simon, the well-respected Pharisee who had his stuff together, who's looked up to by the people, who dresses nice, lives in a nice house, has Jesus over for dinner? Who would you rather be in this story? Simon the Pharisee, well-respected, everything right on the outside. Would you rather be the prostitute in this story, who's a broken mess, that experiences the love and saving grace of Jesus Christ? See, here's why it's a trick question. Most of us who've been a Christian for any length of time, we would answer both. You see, we want to be well-respected. We want to have it all together for people to think about us a certain way, whether it's true or not. We want to keep our problems behind closed doors. When we're in public, we have a smile on our face, like there are no issues. We want to be that person. But we also want to experience the love and saving grace of Jesus Christ. It doesn't work that way. If you want to be made whole, you've got to be broken. There's no way to wholeness except through that door marked broken. If you want to know the love and saving grace of Jesus Christ deeply, if you want that kind of value, that kind of purpose in your life, I'm telling you, it only comes through brokenness. Here's the good news. We're all broken. We are all broken. You are, I am, every single one of us. And those of you who don't think that you are broken, you might be the most broken of all. Because the Pharisee, he's sitting there thinking, she's the one that should be embarrassed. No, he should have been embarrassed. Who's the one that gets rebuked for being broken? It was Simon. And here's how broke Simon was. He spent his whole life studying the scriptures. By the time he was 12, he would have memorized the first 5 books of the Bible. The 300 plus prophecies of the Messiah in the Old Testament. He knew them all by heart. But here is Jesus, that prophesied Messiah, sitting in his house with a cheek that hasn't been kissed, with feet that haven't been washed, and a head that hasn't been anointed with oil. That's how broke he was. He's so broke, he didn't even know he was broke. And that's the thing about brokenness. The less you see it in yourself, the more you need it. And the point of the sermon really isn't that you're broke. You're already broke. The point of the sermon is brokenness, where we stop trying to hide. Where we stop trying to pretend like all the pieces fit together, and instead we say, God, this is it. These are all the broken pieces. You put them back together. You see, there's this TED talk by a lady named Brene Brown. She's a sociologist, and this particular TED talk has had over 15 million hits. It's called The Power of Vulnerability. And in this talk, she talked about how we all need to be at a place and with people with whom we can be vulnerable. But most of us don't have that. We don't know those kinds of relationships. We long, in other words, to admit that we're broken. Down deep, we all know that we are. We long to live with a sense of brokenness, of vulnerability, of authenticity. Just doesn't feel safe. And here's what she says. We are those people. We are those people. You know, that's the truth. Most of us are one paycheck, one divorce, one drug-addicted kid, one mental health diagnosis, one serious illness, one sexual assault, one drinking binge, one night of unprotected sex, or one affair away from being those people. The ones we don't trust. The ones that we pity. The ones that we don't let our children play with. The ones that bad things happen to. The ones that we don't want living next door. We are those people. You're one of them, and I'm one of them. Look around. Everyone in this room is one of those. I don't know how impressive they may look on the outside, but I'm telling you, we're all broken. We are the people who ignore the hurts of others as long as our needs are taken care of. We are those people that yell at each other in the car on the way to church, but when we get out, we smile and act as if everything's okay. We're the people who think that God is somehow more impressed Because we've come up with a whole list of our own rules that aren't even mentioned in the Bible. And when we follow those, and we hold people accountable to them, we're the people who go into debt to keep up our appearances. We're the people who look down on others because they're different from us in some way. We're the people who work 50 plus hours a week trying to prove our worth. We're the people who take the easy way out and log into that porn site. We're the ones who have holes punched in our closet doors. We're the people who spend hours on social media trying to convince people that our lives are somehow better than they really are. We're those people. We're all broken. Every single one of us. And there's no one here who's more deserving or more worthy of God's love and grace than anyone else. So what do we do with that? The sad thing is that we try and hide brokenness. That's what you do with brokenness, right? I mean, ask any kid who's ever broken something. You hide it and hope that nobody ever finds it. They know what to do with it. We do the same thing. We try to hide our brokenness. And as a result, we are the most medicated, the most in debt, the most addicted people in human history. That's what happens when you try to hide your brokenness. It doesn't work. What we need is brokenness where we recognize the reality of our broken condition. Understanding that there is no wholeness except through that door labeled broken. That's the bad news. The good news is the gospel. The good news is that Jesus came to make things whole. The good news is that God makes the broken whole through Jesus Christ. And it's only after being made broken that we're ready to fulfill our purpose and to be used by God. We see this in Isaiah chapter 53, where it says, "But he was wounded for the wrong we did. He was crushed for the evil we did. The punishment which made us well was given to him, and we are healed because of his wounds." I want to look at a couple of words in that verse. Wounded, wounds, refers to bruises in the original language. Comes from broken blood vessels. And then the word whole or heal comes from the root meaning mended, repaired, thoroughly made whole. So in other words, what Isaiah is saying is that we are made whole because he was broken. It's only after being broken that we're really ready to fulfill our purpose to be used by God. And the only way that we really fulfill that purpose, the only way for God's beauty and God's power to be on display is through brokenness. And that's where God does his best work. In Jeremiah chapter 18, it says, "This is the word that came to me from the Lord. Go down at once to the potter's house, and there I will reveal my words to you. So I went down to the potter's house, and there he was working away at the wheel. But the jar that he was making from the clay became flawed in the potter's hand. So he made it into another jar as seemed right for him to do. Then the word of the Lord came to me. I know your jar hasn't turned out how you thought it would. At some point along the way, it's gotten broken. And you can hide the pieces, and you can keep pretending that everything is okay. Or you can say to the potter, will you make this into another jar, one that seems right to you?" And God said, "This is what I want for my people. I know their jar is broken. I know it hasn't turned out the way they want it to. Let me see what I can do with this. You see, there's this ceramic restoration process, and I'm probably going to butcher the name, but it's called Kintsugi. It originated in Japan in the 1500s, and what it is, you take broken ceramic pieces, and you seal them back together. And instead of hiding the cracks are highlighted, and they're traced over with gold to highlight. Here's an example of one. These valuable ceramic pieces that somehow is broken, instead of throwing it away like we would do, you take the pieces and put them back together. Then you accentuate the cracks with the gold. The interesting thing is the value goes up. They are worth more than they were before. And in fact, here's another example. This shows an example of one that has caused some strife in this area. Because some collectors have been accused of purposely breaking a valuable piece like this. Breaking it so that they could then put it back together and trace it with gold so that it would be more valuable afterwards than it was before. This is what God does for us, doesn't he? We're all broken. We all have cracks, and we try to hide them. It's our instinct. But God says, you know what? Those very things that you're most overwhelmed by, that you're most afraid of, the very things that you most want to keep a secret, the very things that you want to be done with, the very thing you wish was not true about you, if you let me, it can be the opportunity. It can be an opportunity to turn it into something beautiful, even more valuable than it was before. You see, the Bible tells us to let our light shine in the world. But here's what we tend to do as a church. We tend to think, okay, what that means is I let my light shine by having everything together. By looking like we have no problems. We've got to figure it out. We think that's how we let our light shine. No problems, no challenges. In reality, our light shines brightest when it's broken. So I thought to myself, what is it? What's an example of something that shines brighter when it's broken? A glow stick shines brighter when it's broken. You see, as a church, we're going to shine brightest in this community when we are a church of those people. When we are a church where we understand that we're all broken. We all have struggles. We all have failures and we all have disappointments. We are a church of broken people. Decide who you want to be in that story from Luke chapter 7. Do you want to be the person who has it, you know, all together? No problems, everybody's impressed with, well respected. Or do you want to be the person who says, I'm broken, and you experience the love and saving grace of Jesus Christ like never before? Because we all have cracks. We're all broken. But through Jesus, we can be made whole. He doesn't work around our brokenness. works through it. Today, if you want to talk to somebody about your relationship with Jesus, what it means to follow him, if you want to give him the broken pieces of your life, your marriage, your family, whatever it is, I'm not going to go to the back door today. I'm going to stay down here in front. Maybe you're ready to become part of this broken church where we are all those people. You're welcome here. If you want to talk to somebody about that, I'll be down here. Come and talk to me. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, would you allow us as a family here to stop pretending and to just be broken, to recognize that in our brokenness you have so much power to make us whole again. Lord, I know that right now there are some of us that want to hide these broken pieces. We want to keep it a secret. We don't want to talk about it. We don't want to think about it. But we know, God, that you're waiting for us. As a potter, you say, how about you give me those pieces and let me make something different? Would you do that, God? Would you take our broken pieces and would you make us something new that seems right to you? Would you help us to celebrate our brokenness? To shine as a broken light to this world? Because God, that's where your power and your grace and your love are on full display. In Jesus' name, amen.